We have an update regarding Covenant College from our ruling elder, Brad Harris. So I'm going to give him a few minutes to tell you about Covenant College.
I promise I won't steal Kyle's thunder. It's too important. But, and you may look at this as a PSA. Everybody knows what a PSA is, public service announcement for the PCA's college, Covenant College. Okay. We just got back. Kathy and I went up there, and they installed the seventh president. And the new president, his name is Brad Voiles. And when you get a president of Covenant College, you also get their wife, because it's a place where the role models are very, very, very important. So a lot of people I talk to, particularly students, when I would ask them about the new president, Voiles, they would say, he's a great role model. And even the guy that represented the students when the charges were given for the new president, spoke of him being such a role model, along with Kelly, his wife. So, thinking about what was going on, I had been looking into. Of course, I've been going to Kyle's class, and the person that came to mind was King Loon. Not L-O-O-N, but L-U-N-E. So I just lifted a few things to show you why we think Loon is such an important person. For this is what it means to be king or leader: in every desperate attack and last in every desperate retreat, and when there's hunger in land, as must now and then be in bad years, to wear finer clothes and laugh louder over the scantier meal than any man. That's straight out of the horse and his boy. As a man, you are made to exercise your masculine strength. This is from Rigney, who wrote what it means to be a Narnian, or live like a Narnian. You're called to be a husband. Your mission is to be her head and lead your wife toward every increasing Christ-likeness. If you're blessed to be a father, your mission is to teach your children and to train them in right living under the grace of God. This type of spiritual headship has been described as a man being king in his castle. And everybody I spoke to, and two or three people even mentioned the characteristics of one, a Narnian type leader. So it's very interesting. So if you're a leader or a king, here are the four concepts that would be offered for your consideration based on a good King Loon. Even kings are under authority. A king has a duty. It's not his own. A king leads from the front, and a king sets the tone for those in his kingdom. A husband and a father needs to be a strong leader before his wife and children in the same way. They are looking to their leader, you, and to set emotional and spiritual tone in good and bad times. So, Dr. Voiles, when he spoke, he's a very humble man, and he referenced the fact that personally he couldn't do this without God's help, but he can do it because he has hope and he leans on Christ. I've never known a man that leans on Christ more than he. I'm sure there are plenty do so. Rigney goes on to say, and I might tell you this is why we admire President Voiles, who came up through the ranks 19 years. He went to DePaul University originally, but he came up, and now he was dean of the students, etc. But why do I admire Loon so much? And I'm lifting this right from Rigney. It applies. Before I tell you why I admire Loon, let me draw attention to something. Here's Lewis's view of education. This idea, what I'm about to do, admiring Loon and wanting you to be like him when I grow up, wanting to be like a fictional character when I grow up, what is that? Well, Lewis understands that we as human beings are imitative creatures. Children imitate their parents and their siblings. Young ball players imitate their favorite athletes. Students imitate their teachers, and that's very critical in that small, tight community of Covenant College. And preachers imitate their heroes. Even Kyle might imitate his hero. I'm not sure who that would be. But we do imitate who we admire, and I would just ask you to partner with me as we support Covenant College And we covet your prayers, particularly Dr. Voile's last words were, please pray for me, when he gave his inaugural address. Please pray for me. So we covet your prayers, and we even covet your financial support. I know that's surprising to you. Thank you, Kyle.
All right. Thank you, Brad. That was actually providential because I was hoping to be able to cover the chapter on King Loon in Joe Rigney's book, Live Like a Narnian, but for the sake of time, I wasn't able to cover it. So I'm glad you were able to mention it in your announcement this morning. So yes, this morning we're going to be discussing the horse and his boy. By the way, happy St. Patrick's Day, everybody. Here's your public service announcement for the morning. What color are you supposed to wear if you're a Protestant? Orange, okay? Yes, orange. Very good. All right. So anyway, yes, we are on the tail end of the class now. So this morning, we're going to be discussing the horse and his boy. Next week, we'll be discussing Mercury from Michael Ward's book, Planet Narnia. And just so you're aware, we will not have Sunday school classes for Easter Sunday. So just be aware of that. Okay, as usual, I'm going to start with some trivia questions for you. This week, they're going to be a little bit easier. Next week, I'm going to ramp up the difficulty a couple notches. So let's see, how well do you know the horse and his boy? If you've read it relatively recently, hopefully you can answer some of these, hopefully most of these. But take a minute, look at the questions, and we'll see how you do. All right, should we look at these together? Let's do it. Number one, where did Arshish first find Shasta as a baby? By the seashore, that's right. So he was in like a lifeboat. The man who had rescued Shasta or had, you know, saved Shasta's life, he had died in the boat. And so the baby Shasta was on the brink of death, but then Arshish came across him and raised him as his own, but was not a very kind man towards Shasta. All right, number two, what is the title of the ruler of Kalorman? The Tisrock. Very good. Bonus question. What is the title of the nobility of Kalorman? Tarkan. That's right. Tarkan. All right. Number three. Who is Erebus betrothed to marry against her will? It's Ahoshta. Ahoshta Tarkan. Who is, what role does he play? Like, what's his job? He's the Grand Vizier. Exactly. Yeah, he's the Grand Vizier. Okay, who does Shasta look exactly like? Prince Corin. Prince Corin, that's right. Number five, whom does Rabadash, the prince, want to marry? Queen Susan, very good, very good. Number six, where does Aslan appear to Shasta as a cat at night? The tombs, that's right, the tombs of the ancient kings, right on the boundary between Tashban and the desert. Okay, number seven, who helps Erebus escape from Tashban? Lazareline, very good. All right, number eight, this is a little harder. What river borders the great desert and Arkanland? The Winding Arrow, very good. All right, you got it. Number nine, what is Shasta's real name? Kor, Prince Kor. He is the twin brother of Prince Corin. And number 10, what animal does Rabadash get turned into? A donkey, and so that's why he inherits the title Rabadash the Ridiculous. All right, so those are your trivia questions. I'm going to ramp it up a notch next week, so we'll see how you guys do. Yeah. All right, what I want to do here is give you a basic plot synopsis. Hopefully this isn't going to take too terribly long, but I want to give you some idea of what is the plot of The Horse and His Boy. This one, okay, in my opinion, this one is the most fun of the Chronicles of Narnia. It's the fastest-paced story, but it's also kind of like a side quest. You know, it doesn't involve the main characters. The Pevensies are there. I don't think Peter's there, though. But the that's right, that's right. So he doesn't make an appearance in this book. And the other siblings, they're there, but they are not the main characters. The main characters are Shasta and Bree, the horse, and then Erebus and Huynh. So those are the main characters. So it's not the Pevensey kids. It's not Jill and Eustace like in the other books. But it's probably the most fun book, I would argue. But let me try to summarize the plot for you using this map. So here you can see a map of the nation of Calormen, which is two countries to the south of Narnia. And what's the country between them? Arkenland. Very good. And that's where Shasta was originally from, and that's where the story ends as well. So basically what happens at the beginning of the story is Shasta is at his home with Arshish, and I think they live along the shoreline. I think, isn't Arshish like a fisherman or something like that? And one day, a Tarkon arrives and offers to purchase Shasta. Shasta, I think, is like in the stables or he's away, so he only eavesdrops on the conversation. But he finds out in the midst of the conversation between Arshish and the Tarkon that Arshish is not his real father. That he actually found him on the shoreline when he was a baby, on the brink of death in this lifeboat. And so he raised him as his own, but treated him very cruelly as a child. And so Shasta talks to himself about how much he wishes he could just escape and flee to the north. He's always had this dream of traveling northwards. And then it turns out that the Tarkon's horse starts talking to him and says, hey, how about we both leave for the north together? That turns out to be Bree. Who is originally a talking horse from Narnia, but I can't remember all the details here. He was captured, and then he was like forced to work as a pack horse, and he pretended to be just a mute pack horse in Calormen. So that was Bree's experience in Calormen. He hated life, you know, serving this Tarkon. So he hatches this plan for him and Shasta to escape to the north. So they leave, and they make their way towards Tashban, which is the capital of Calormen. Along the way, they encounter another rider on a horse, and then they both get chased by lions. And they are running, and eventually, like, the lion forces them to join together, and they're able to outrun the lion. But then they start talking to one another and find out they're all of them are fleeing. Right. So this is Erebus and her horse. It turns out that Erebus is a native Calormene, but she has been betrothed, like the trivia question, against her will to this Tarkon, who is much, much older than her and ugly, and she doesn't want to marry him. And she's like about to take her own life, and then her horse talks to her and says, don't do that. I have another idea. Let's escape to the north. Turns out that Huynh is a talking Narnian horse as well. And so let's see, how does the storyline go? Erebus has this plan. She tells her dad, the one who's forcing her into this marriage, well, give me like 3 days to do this ceremony to the god to prepare for the wedding. And during that time, that gives her a head start, so she escapes. And I think they're already on the fourth day of her escape. And that's when they join up with Shasta and Bree. Together, they enter into Tashban. And when they're in Tashban, there's like crowds everywhere. It's like, and you can see it's a very stratified society. You know, the lower classes are just in squalor and filth. But the closer you get to the neighborhoods of the nobility, things are just opulent and beautiful and luxurious. But it's a very power-based society, honor-based society. They also encounter some Narnians in the city of Tashban. And one of the Narnians spots Shasta and mistakes him for Prince Corin, who he looks like because they're identical twins. And so he says to him, Corin, where have you been this whole time? Snatches up Shasta, brings him to like the quarters of the Narnians. And it turns out that this is King Edmund and Queen Susan. Peter and Lucy are not there at that moment. But they have this conversation, and it becomes apparent that Queen Susan is intending to turn down the marriage offer of Prince Rabadash. But they have a suspicion that Rabadash is not going to like this, and he's going to force them to stay. And they're afraid that like they're going to be kidnapped, and she's going to be forced into the marriage against her will. So they hatch this plan of their own to escape. They say that they are intending to say yes. She is intending to say yes to Prince Rabadash, but they have to make party preparations for a big feast. So that gives them the opportunity to leave their quarters and make it to the dock onto their ship so that they can sail back to Cair Paravel. How am I doing on the details so far? For those of you that know the story, am I good so far? Okay. This whole plan is overheard by Shasta, who they think is Prince Corin, but he's not. But then I think later that night, The real Prince Corn sneaks in through the window, and I think he has like a black eye and a missing tooth or something like that because he'd gotten into a fight because he was, you know, messing around in the city. So he comes back, and they exchange conversations, and then Shasta leaps through the window himself to try to meet up with Erebus. They had a plan that if they ever got separated, they would meet again at the tombs of the ancient kings on the outskirts of the city. Shasta shows up there, and they're not there, so he has no idea what to do. It's getting dark, but then this cat shows up, and he decides to fall asleep there in the tombs with the cat. And he can hear, like, this howling or something at night, which turns out to be jackals, but he also hears this roar, and something scares them off. He looks around, doesn't see anything except the cat. And then the next day, he wakes up, and he sees the horses, Bree and Huyn, being led by this servant that he doesn't recognize. Is that correct? Okay. Then the storyline switches over to what happened to Erebus and the horses once Shasta got taken by the Narnians. Turns out that Erebus ran into somebody who recognized her. That was her friend Lazareline, who was also Calormine nobility. Very superficial, really only into like gossip and makeup and all that. Turns out to be very similar to how Queen Susan turns out to be, you know, on Earth towards the end of her, you know, life. Erebus convinces Lazareline to keep her identity a secret because she doesn't want to be forced into this marriage with the Grand Vizier. And so Lazareline tries to find a way of sneaking her out of the city, but then they encounter the Tizrak himself, and they have to flee in the opposite direction, and they hide in this room within the palace. But it turns out to be the very room where the Tizrak and his advisors were going. And so they have to hide behind the couch, and then the Tizrak is there, and his son, Prince Rabadash, and the Grand Vizier, Ahoshtatar Khan. And they talk about how the Narnians have escaped. So we know this is a few hours after the Narnians hatched this plan. And they're really angry. Rabadash is furious because he was intending to marry Queen Susan, and he's willing to wage war on the Narnians. But then he has an idea of his own. He tells his dad, how about this? I will go to Cair Paravel myself. I will kidnap Queen Susan and bring her back here. But on my way, I'm going to conquer the capital of Arkenland. Does anybody know the name of the capital of Arkenland? Anvard. Very good. All right. So he's intending to take 200 men. They're going to besiege the city of Anvard on their way to Cair Paravel. And that will be a strategic advantage for the Tizrak, because then they will actually control Arkenland to prepare for the future potential invasion of Narnia. And the Tizrak says, love the idea, but I need plausible deniability here. So if anybody catches you doing this, you're on your own, all right? I knew nothing about this. So that's the idea. And now Erebus and Lazareline, who are hiding behind the couch the whole time, hear all this, and so they freak out. Erebus has one of Lazareline's servants take the horses to the tombs because she can't leave just yet. So that is who Shasta encounters at the tombs. It's the servant of Lazareline with the horses. Then Erebus later shows up to the tombs as well, and the servant leaves. And then they have their plan to cross the great central desert there to try to outrun the forces of Rabadash and the Calormine soldiers to try to get to Anvard before they do. But they got to hustle. That's why this is such a fast-paced story. So they have to go through this desert. It takes them a couple days to do it. They're like on the brink of, you know, like dying of thirst. But they finally make it. They cross the Winding Arrow. Who's the first person that they encounter on the other side of the Winding Arrow? The Hermit. The Hermit of the Southern March. Right, and so he welcomes them into his home, but Shasta has to keep moving. I think on the way to the Hermit of the Southern March, they also encounter Aslan one more time, right? And he's like chasing them. He even like scratches Erebus, but then like Shasta like jumps off the horse and like chases off the lion. You don't really chase off Aslan, but he thinks he does. And then like they're just on the point of exhaustion, right? They're so tired. But they make it to the Hermit, and the Hermit says, you got to keep going, bro, because, like, there's no time to waste, because the Rabadash and the Calormines are right behind you. And so he's, like, booking it towards Anvard. And on the way, he finally encounters King Lune and the Arkenlanders. Is that what you call them, Arkenlanders? And Lune initially mistakes him for his son, Prince Corrin. But then Shasta says, no, I'm not Corrin, but I have a warning for you. I have a message. You have Calormine soldiers that are on their way to capture your city. So They give Shasta a horse, and they all make their way back towards Anvard. But then it's night, and they're in the mountain passes. Shasta gets separated from them. He takes a wrong turn. And then in the middle of the night, that's where he hears this voice, which turns out to be who? This is Aslan, who says, I was with you the whole time, through the whole journey. And the lions that you were afraid of that whole time, there was only one lion. It was me. Right, and I'll have more to say about that scene later on. It's beautiful. It's one of my favorite encounters with Aslan in the entire Chronicles of Narnia. So we'll talk about that one later. So Aslan refreshes him. There's a paw print in the ground that turns into a stream, and so Shasta drinks from it, and he's rejuvenated, and he is able to make it. He doesn't go to Anvard. He actually makes it to the outskirts of Narnia, where I think there's like a hedgehog that like brings him to a dwarf, and then like the message gets out that, hey, Arkenland is in trouble. We need to like rally the troops from Narnia to help our friends in Arkenland. And so the word gets out, and so all these forces are gathered together right as Anvard is under siege. And it's like just in time, right? So Edmund shows up as well. And I think Lucy's there too. She shows up in the storyline at this time as well. And there's a big fight at the climax of the story. Of course, the Narnians and the Arkenlanders win. And they manage to capture Rabadash, who is like refusing to accept the terms of surrender. Aslan finally shows up and turns him into a donkey and says, okay, you go back to the Temple of Tash a Tashban, and you'll turn back into a human, but you can never go more than 10 miles away from the temple. Otherwise, you're going to turn back into a donkey permanently. And then what happens is Shasta comes to realize he really is Prince Kor, the son, the older son of King Lune, so he ends up inheriting the throne. He and Erebus later in life get married as well, and they live happily ever after. How did I do? I think I pretty accurately covered the details of the story. So that is your plot synopsis for the horse and his boy. I do have some themes that we're going to look at. My suspicion is we're not going to get through all of these themes today, but that's okay, because next week we're going to be talking about the mercurial elements of the story as well, looking at Michael Ward's planet Narnia, and I can finish discussing some of these if we don't get to all of them. Hopefully, though, we can cover at least two or three of them today. So we're going to take a look at the themes of Sehnsucht, which is a German word, reward, self-regard, and providence. Those are our key themes today. So let me begin with the theme of Sehnsucht. By the way, does anybody recognize that term? You have to be a real C.S. Lewis fan to know what Sehnsucht is. Okay, so I see a couple hands. Micah, do you know what Sehnsucht is? That's perfect. Yeah. That's like word for word. Yeah, I have that quote up here, actually. Yes, the desire for a far-off country. That's a good way of describing Sehnsucht. Art, do you want to add to that? Yes, this is the theme you see in both his fiction and his nonfiction. So it's a German word that doesn't really translate easily into English. The best I could come up with is yearn-seeking. It's a deep longing, a feeling of nostalgia or homesickness, which it's like an ache, but it's an ache that feels sweet. Like you want to feel it. Like it comes and it goes and you wish you could feel it again, even though it leaves you with an achy feeling for something bigger, something more, something that's beyond anything that this world can satisfy. That's the idea of Sehnsucht. And for Lewis, Sehnsucht is best symbolized by the concept of northernness. And that is a central theme within The Horse and His Boy. Look in chapter 1 what it says about Shasta, who's raised in Calormen, but his heart belongs to the north. Here's what it says. But Shasta was very interested in everything that lay to the north because no one ever went that way, and he was never allowed to go there himself. When he was sitting out of doors mending the nets and all alone, he would often look eagerly to the north. So this is an insight into Shasta's character that we learn at the very beginning of the story. When he finally has that conversation with the horse, Bree, and they hatch the plan to flee towards Narnia, here's Shasta's comments. Oh, hurrah, said Shasta, then we'll go north. I've been longing to go to the north all my life. Of course you have, said the horse. That's because of the blood that's in you. I'm sure, your true northern stock. So Shasta does not look like a Kalormine. You know, the Kalormines have like a more desert complexion because they live at a more southern latitude. So Shasta's more fair-skinned. It's very apparent that he's not native to this region. So the horse recognizes right away, this guy's, he's a Narnian, right? He belongs in the north. More accurately, he's an Arkanlander, though. Anyway, here's where Lewis talks about this idea of northernness and connects it to this idea of Sehnsucht. This comes from Lewis's autobiography, Surprised by Joy. How many of you have ever read Surprised by Joy before? Okay, so there is a handful of you. At the beginning of the story, of his autobiography, he talks about how from a very early age, he fell in love with Norse poetry. And here's what he has to say about his encounter. I think this is from a poem by Longfellow, if I'm correct. Lewis says, I heard a voice that said, Balder the Beautiful is dead. So Balder, you know, is a dying and rising god from Norse mythology. Then Lewis goes on to say, I knew nothing about Balder, but instantly I was uplifted into huge regions of northern sky. I desired with almost sickening intensity something never to be described, except that it is cold, spacious, severe, pale, and remote. And then found myself at that very same moment already falling out of that desire and wishing I were back in it. This was one of his first encounters with Sehnsucht, this longing for a country he's never been to before. And here we see why Lewis associated with northernness. And this was true for all of Lewis's life. He always felt like his heart was in the north. Here's another quote where Lewis develops this idea of Sehnsucht. How many of you have ever read The Weight of Glory before? This is one of his most famous essays. And here's an excerpt from it. It's kind of a long passage, but I think it's worth quoting in full. Here's where Lewis is developing this idea of Sehnsucht. In speaking of this desire for our own far-off country, there it is, Micah, exactly right, which we find in ourselves even now, I feel a certain shyness. I'm almost committing an indecency. I'm trying to rip open the inconsolable secret in each one of you, the secret which hurts so much that you take your revenge on it by calling it names like nostalgia and romanticism and adolescence. In other words, we're almost embarrassed to admit that we have this longing because it makes us feel childish. But there is a reason why, you know, Jesus himself said you must become like a child in order to enter the kingdom of heaven, right? Children recognize that sense of longing. In adults, we feel almost embarrassed by the feeling, but it's there for a reason. God hardwired us with this longing so that we might seek him. To continue the quote, the secret also which pierces with such sweetness that when in very intimate conversation, the mention of it becomes imminent, we grow awkward and affect to laugh at ourselves. The secret we cannot hide and cannot tell, though we desire to do both. We cannot tell it because it is a desire for something that has never actually appeared in our experience. We cannot hide it because our experience is constantly suggesting it, and we betray ourselves like lovers at the mention of a name. Our commonest expedient is to call it beauty and behave as if that had settled the matter. Which, by the way, that's what the Romantic poets did in like the early 1800s in England. So there's a whole movement of literature and poetry where they sort of substituted God with beauty. Even one of my favorite authors, Roger Scruton, does the same thing. You know, he's not quite a Christian, as far as I can tell. But they almost deify beauty. And that's what Lewis is commenting about here. But he says that's a dead end. This is all a cheat. The books or the music in which we thought the beauty was located will betray us if we trust to them. It was not in them, it only came through them. And what came through them was longing. These things, the beauty, the memory of our own past, are good images of what we really desire. But if they are mistaken for the thing itself, they turn into dumb idols, breaking the hearts of their worshipers. For they are not the thing itself. They are only the scent of a flower we have not found, the echo of a tune we have not heard, news from a country we have never yet visited. Can any of you resonate with that feeling? I think this is perhaps one of the most powerful arguments for Christianity. We are hardwired with this desire. We are made that way by God. This is why St. Augustine could pray, "Our hearts are restless until they rest in you." It's this same idea that there is a God-shaped hole within our heart. We've talked about a similar idea when we looked at the voyage of the Dawn Treader. You might remember the character Reepicheep. What was his goal in the voyage? He wanted to go to Aslan's country, right? The difference is Reepicheep knew where he was heading. Shasta did not. He had this inarticulate longing. He'd never been to the north. But he could still tell within his own heart that he was meant for something more. There was something greater that would fulfill his desires. And if we settle for all the cheap substitutes around us, no, these are good things, but they are no substitute for the real thing that will satisfy our longing, which is a relationship with God himself. This, by the way, is the whole point of the book of Ecclesiastes. So you might remember in Ecclesiastes 3:11, where Solomon says, God has put eternity in man's heart. We have that longing in our heart for something eternal. There is something that transcends our experience, which is the only thing that can satisfy that longing within our heart. As Lewis put it elsewhere in Mere Christianity, if I find in myself a desire which nothing on this earth can satisfy, the only logical explanation is that there's another world, right, that will satisfy that longing. This is the idea of Sehnsucht, all right? And this, we see this from the very beginning in the character of Shasta in his longing for the north. And I think there's a very powerful apologetic argument to be made there from that. Here is how the authors Kurt Bruner and Jim Ware describe that feeling of Sehnsucht in their book, Finding God in the Land of Narnia. Have you ever felt that bittersweet pang, that stab of joy, that soul-piercing arrow of heartbreaking loveliness and longing that, for Lewis and Shasta, was shot from the north? It comes to each of us in a different way. We encounter it in the light of a red gold sunset, the melancholy of a misty seascape, the cold beam of stars among bare branches on a winter's night. Wherever we meet it, it confronts us with inescapable evidence that we, like Jack, that's C.S. Lewis, and Shasta and the Old Testament patriarchs, are strangers and pilgrims on the earth, exiles in a foreign land, hoping to discover a way back home. So that's the theme of Sehnsucht. Let's take a look at our next theme, which is reward. This one is a little bit harder to explain, perhaps. And it might not be as apparent that this is a central theme to the book. But here is how Lewis describes it in chapter 10. So this is at the point where they have finally encountered the Hermit of the Southern March, and they realize they can't stop now. They got to keep going in order to get the message to King Lune and to Anvard that they're going to be under attack. So Shasta had not yet learned that if you do one good deed, your reward usually is to be set to do another and harder and better one. And these are the words of the hermit to Shasta. And now, my son, waste no time on questions, but obey. This damsel is wounded. Your horses are spent. Rabadash is at this moment finding a ford over the winding arrow. If you run now without a moment's rest, you will still be in time to warn King Lune. So he's got to keep going. He's got to keep running. I think that there is a parallel we can draw between Shasta's experience of having to keep pressing forward and the Christian life as well. Joe Rigney talks about this theme in his book, Live Like a Narnian. And he talks about how often Christians can have a mountaintop experience, you know, a spiritual high. This is especially true for like high school and college age students, where they have this mountaintop experience with God, but then at some point they encounter some sort of roadblock in life. They find themselves in the doldrums. They find themselves in a spiritual pit. And they don't know how to get out of it. They question, have they done something wrong? No. Often what happens for those who persevere, it's evidence that they've been promoted, right? It is part of the process of sanctification. You cannot stay on the mountaintop forever. God will actually use you to accomplish his purposes. And in order to use you effectively, often God puts us through trials. He puts us through hardship. And he pushes us beyond the limits that we think we can go. So here's how Rigney comments on this theme of reward. Our lives are to be a long obedience in the same direction. And our direction is far more important than our pace. It's not unusual on this journey to grow faint and weary, even at times to stumble and fall. But hoping in the Lord, we can renew our strength and endeavor by grace to be faithful in little so that God will put us over much. In faithfully obeying even when it's hard, in pushing our spiritual muscles to their limit, in running with trembling limbs, a stitch in our side and sweat in our eyes, we show ourselves to be true sons and daughters of Arkenland and win from the lion a great and happy reward. This quote reminded me of a particular Bible passage where the reward that God gives to his people is more responsibility. What does that call to mind for you? Does anybody know it? Where in the Bible do we see the reward for faithfulness is more responsibility? The parable of the talents. I think I heard a few people say it. You might recall in Matthew 25, where Jesus is telling the parable of the talents. In that parable, the servant's master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." A couple things to notice here. First of all, the reward is joy. But there's also a responsibility there. There's an authority communicated there. I will set you over much. Have you ever wondered, like, what are we actually going to be doing in heaven? There's all sorts of speculation. Of course, we're going to be worshiping God. That's the main thing, without doubt. But what does it mean that this servant gets set over much? What will that authority, what will that responsibility look like? I have no idea. Your guess is as good as mine. But we do know that God's not done with us in heaven. We will still have some kind of job to do in addition to glorifying and enjoying him forever. Or in fact, perhaps that job is the means by which we glorify and enjoy him forever. It's going to be awesome, whatever it is. But it is going to involve much greater responsibility than we have now. So that's the theme of reward that we see in the horse and his boy. Perhaps the final thing we'll look at today, and then we'll save the theme of providence for next week, is the theme of self-regard. I found here a picture from the internet of the Calormenes. And I want to ask you, how would you describe Calormene culture? The Calormene people, in contrast to the Narnians, what are the Calormenes like? Self-indulgent. They're image conscious. Very good. Any other words come to mind? They're rude. They can be rude. But it's rudeness behind a veneer of politeness, right? It's like almost like passive-aggressive, you could say. Arrogant. They're always communicating this false image. It's a false eloquence, right? Like they make them sound very sophisticated. But underneath it, they're very selfish and self-absorbed. A lot of people have criticized Lewis's characterization of the Calormenes for coming across as racist or as ethnocentric. Because he it's very apparent in the way he describes them that he got the inspiration for them from Middle Eastern culture, right? From Islamic culture. Like if you look at the culture of Arabs and Turks and Persians, that's very much behind the description of the Calormenes. Now, Lewis is not intending to communicate a racist message here, though. That would be to draw the wrong lesson from it. Because, of course, there are individual Calormenes that are virtuous. I mean, think of Erebus, or in the last battle, think of Emeth. All right, so he's not like painting with a broad brush that they're all horrible. But he is saying that cultures are not morally neutral. Lewis would be a critic of multiculturalism, okay? Some cultures can exhibit more virtue than others. And it depends on what is the central object of worship within this culture. Here's what Joe Rigney has to say about it. For Lewis, underneath culture is cultus, worship. And if you worship a bloodthirsty and demonic god like Tash, then your culture will come to reflect him. Just as if you worship a liberating and loving deity like Aslan, your culture will reflect him. So the reason why Lewis has such a negative attitude towards the Calormene culture is because they're all centered around a false god. And that false worship expresses itself in distorted customs, distorted values, an oppressive way of treating other people, in contrast to the Narnians, whose central object of worship is the true god, Aslan. So it's about worship, and it's about the central object of worship. That's Lewis's cultural commentary here. And so that would explain all of these features of Calorming society, their oppressive hierarchy, the forced flattery, the false affectation, the groveling resentment, especially as we see in the character of Ahoshta Tarkan, the Grand Vizier. So it's a culture centered around self-regard. That's the problem. And it's based on a false system of worship. And in fact, this false attitude, this false pride, this self-regard, has affected even Bree himself, who is originally from Narnia, but having spent so much time in Calorman, he's adopted this prideful attitude, this self-regarding attitude from the Calormans around him. And this is something that Bree continually struggles through throughout the storyline of The Horse and His Boy. He has to overcome his own self-regard. And so finally, you know, when they finally encounter the Hermit of the Southern March, you know, this is after Aslan has just chased them, and Aslan has, like, scratched Erebus, and Shast is the one who has to jump off of Bree and chase off Aslan. After that encounter, Bree feels very ashamed. He feels like a coward. He feels like he can no longer show his face in Narnia because of the way that he has acted. But in response, this is what the Hermit says to Bree. "My good horse, you've lost nothing but your self-conceit. If you are really so humbled as you sounded a minute ago, you must learn to listen to sense. You're not quite the great horse you had come to think from living among poor, dumb horses. Of course you were braver and cleverer than them. You could hardly help being that. It doesn't follow that you'll be anyone very special in Narnia. But as long as you know you're nobody very special, you'll be a very decent sort of horse on the whole, and taking one thing with another." How's that for words of encouragement? You're not all that special, but maybe you could live a decent life. That is probably like the description of most of the Christian life in comparison to other believers. You might have some unique spiritual gift. You might have some special calling that God will use and will give you a feeling of significance. And that can be validated, okay? That's a good thing. But in a lot of your life, you might not be anything special. You might be pretty mediocre in a lot of what you do in life. If you're trying to compare yourself to other people, other Christians. But you know what? The good news is that's not the standard God holds us to, right? I mean, the good news and the bad news is God holds us to an infinitely higher standard than that, right? But the encouragement we can take as Christians is that Jesus met that standard for us, right? Which is why we can still be confident recognizing all of our flaws, right? We're never going to reach that standard of perfection. We're never going to be, above and beyond everyone in every way. We can be okay with our mediocrity, in a sense. And so that is what Lewis actually has to say about the theme of pride in mere Christianity, when he's contrasting pride with real humility. This is a somewhat extended quote, but I think it's worth quoting in full here, so I'm going to read it for you. "We must not think pride is something God forbids because he is offended at it, or that humility is something he demands as his due to his own dignity, as if God himself was proud. He's not in the least worried about his dignity. The point is, he wants you to know him, wants to give you himself. And he and you are two things of such a kind that if you really get into any kind of touch with him, you will, in fact, be humble, delightedly humble, feeling the infinite relief of having for once got rid of all the silly nonsense about your own dignity, which has made you restless and unhappy all your life. He is trying to make you humble in order to make this moment possible, trying to take off a lot of silly, ugly, fancy dress in which we have all got ourselves up and are strutting about like the little idiots we are. I wish I had got a bit further with humility myself. If I had, I could probably tell you more about the relief, the comfort of taking the fancy dress off, getting rid of the false self with all its look at me and aren't I a good boy, and all its posing and posturing. To get even near it, even for a moment, is like a drink of cold water to a man in a desert." That does kind of resemble the horse and his boy, right? This is the picture of what it means to live like a Narnian in contrast to a Calormene. Because when Shasta actually encounters the Narnians in the capital city of Tashban, he notices that they act very differently from all the Calormenes in the city. Notice what Shasta observes in their behavior. It was quite unlike any other party they had seen that day. The crier who went before it shouting, "Way, way," was the only Calormene in it. And there was no litter. Everyone was on foot. There were about half a dozen men, and Shasta had never seen anyone like them before. And instead of being grave and mysterious like most Calormenes, they walked with a swing and let their arms and shoulders go free and chatted and laughed. One was whistling. You could see that they were ready to be friends with anyone who was friendly and didn't give a fig for anyone who wasn't. Shasta thought he had never seen anything so lovely in his life. When you have embraced Christian humility, when you have truly entered into a relationship with God, that frees you from this concern for self-regard. That allows you to walk with humility, to live like a Narnian. So those are the themes we'll be looking at today, or the themes that we'll stick with today. Next week, we'll conclude with the theme of providence, and then we'll talk about some of the mercurial elements in The Horse and His Boy, looking at Michael Ward's book, Planet Narnia. With that said, are there any questions or comments for the lesson today? All right, well, let me close our time in prayer, and then we can get ready for corporate worship. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for accepting us in spite of ourselves. We thank you that you treat us not according to our own merits, but according to the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you that because of that free gift, we can have confidence. We do not have to be enslaved to self-regard or conceit, but that we can walk with true humility. And we thank you, Lord, for the tasks that you have given us. And we pray, Lord, that we would have the courage to embrace greater responsibility as we progress in the Christian life. And we thank you, Lord, that you satisfy the deepest longings of our heart, that you have made us for yourself, and that in you our hearts can finally find rest. So we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity for corporate worship this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to gather with your people to sing praises to your name. We give you the glory in all that we do, in Christ's name. Amen.